John Ledger curses the EFF via Periscope. Edward Snowden comes to CES inside a robot, and an animal can't own a photograph, ya monkey. All that and more on Tech News Today.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Tech News Today is provided by Cashfly at cachefly.com.
This is Tech News Today, episode 1423, recorded Thursday, January 7th, 2016. This episode of Tech News Today is brought to you by Epson's new EcoTank printers. With Epson's line of SuperTank all-in-one printers, you can print thousands of documents without running out of ink. EcoTank is loaded and ready to print when you are. Visit epson.com/ecotank to find out more. And by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/TNT.
And by FreshBooks, the super simple cloud accounting software that's giving thousands of freelancers and small businesses the tools to save time billing and get paid faster. Try it free at FreshBooks.com/TNT. Hello, welcome to Tech News Today. This is the show where we talk about all the tech news with people who are passionate about the tech news, experts, journalists, all the people. Thanks for coming and joining us.
Yes, right. Who are you?
I am Megan Morrone.
Oh, okay. Because I forgot there for a second. I'm Jason Howell. How's it going?
Good. Thank you.
We're getting there. It's week one. We'll figure this all out. Sorry, maybe that was a little too forward. Joining us today for the full episode, we're super stoked to have him here, Nathan Olivarez-Giles from the Wall Street Journal. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing good. Just cracking up at you two right now.
Sorry. We play a little loose, I think, around here. Maybe a little too loose at times, but we do what we can.
Yeah, thanks for so much for coming on, Nathan. It's really exciting to talk to you. Let's get to the biggest stories of the day. Sources tell Business Insider that Yahoo will soon lay off 10% of its workforce, although the company has not confirmed or denied this rumor. The cuts are expected to affect the media arm of the company, but we don't know any more specifics than that. And we could probably all have guessed this even without those sources. The number 1,000 employees is very specific, which could make it true. Now, joining us to talk about this story and Yahoo in general is Alex Wilhelm, editor-in-chief at Mattermark, a site dedicated to tracking the world's fastest-growing companies and investors. Welcome, Alex.
Hey, how's it going? Good to be back.
So what do you make of these rumors, these layoff rumors at Yahoo?
Complete lack of surprise, honestly. I mean, I've been hearing rumors about impending layoffs there for, I want to say, 4 to 6 months. I never had any really hard sources on it, so I couldn't really report it myself, but the conversation has been around for a long time. And given the company's continued lackluster financial performance, you have to make some cuts. And so 10% sounds like a lot. I would have guessed 5, but I'm just completely not surprised this has happened.
So, you know, the other thing that we heard is that Marissa Mayer might be on the chopping block again. We hear that all the time. Yes. I think maybe it's just wishful thinking on the part of some people. I mean, Yahoo is a company in flux. So what do you think about that rumor?
Well, I mean, look at today. Yahoo was down, I think, 6.2% in regular hours and down more after hours. It was a bad day for markets in general, but Yahoo took it really hard. And Starboard, an activist investor group that owns about 0.8% of Yahoo, released a very scathing memo, essentially calling for her head. Given the lack of turnaround at the company on a financial basis. So things are kind of lining up. You know, you've got layoffs, you've got activist pressure, you've got a really, really tough stock price. I don't know what's really keeping her in the slot other than her tenacity and intelligence, frankly.
And it's mainly the, I mean, right now what we're looking at is, aside from the fact that Marissa Mayer is kind of fighting for her job at this point, but a lot of Yahoo's kind of media entities are kind of feeling it the worst, I would imagine. Would you agree with that, Nathan?
Yeah, I mean, recently they shut down Screen, which was like the cornerstone of the, you know, media content push, right? So Katie Couric and having, you know, shows like Community and all of these things on, that big push, it all kind of really pointed towards Screen. And shutting that down, that kind of feels like an admission that maybe content delivery isn't, you know, going to work out for them, which is crazy because so much of what they do is dependent on that, getting people to show up and, you know, take part in these different services they're offering. So if they're not a destination, if people aren't going to them, how else are they going to lure in new customers and rebuild this business? It's a huge question. I don't really know what Yahoo, you know, wants to be per se. I feel like, you know, when Mayer took over in 2012, we kind of had that idea that it's going to focus on content. And now I think that's a big open question. And like Alex is saying, I'm not sure how much more time she has to reposition and restructure this entire company around what idea.
I thought it was supposed to be mobile. What happened to that?
They talked a lot about mobile, but all of those products were basically with a mobile focus, but still kind of focused on content again, right? So,
right. No, I agree with you. I'm just surprised at how much that push didn't work out. I mean, they're selling more mobile ads than ever, but they're showing a real decline in their per ad price. So I'm not quite sure if it's a plus one, minus one situation or not.
Yeah. So where does it go from here? I don't know if anyone has a good answer, especially Marissa Meyer.
I think that's the core of the problem. I mean, they announced they were going to stream one concert every day of 2015. And I was like, okay, but why? Why would you do that? They did it, and then I think it had very little impact. I mean, Community is a good example of their failed content strategy. Do we think they have any chance of pulling off content, or do they just go full mobile and not focus on user-generated stuff?
It's a really good question, especially when you consider the fact that they threw so much at it for the past three or so years, and you know, including big names, names that you recognize, names that you trust, all of that behind it to show how dedicated they wanted to be perceived as, anyways, as far as that's concerned. And that still didn't really make much of a difference. It certainly didn't send a ripple through the industry and you know, remind people that that's where you go for that kind of content. So I don't know. I almost think they do need to rethink it, but they're getting really used to having to rethink their strategy at this point. And at a certain point, people just kind of lose interest entirely.
I think everyone knows when you're having a hard time, you hire David Pogue and that solves all your problems.
Well, you know, Alex, you bring up a great point though with the mobile thing. I mean, if content isn't going to be the focus of their push, I mean, what are they going to go mobile with, right? I mean, mobile is what everybody's talking about right now. It's kind of like the default buzz concept. That's where you start these days, rather than desktop web. But I don't know. It's been 3 years. It's just how much longer can the world wait?
I liked their idea of focusing on daily habits, email, finance, weather, and all of that. But the thing is, they don't have their own platform. They're playing on everyone else's platform where they can't be natively installed. They're always at a disadvantage. So they can try to build better stuff, and that works in some cases. But it's definitely an uphill battle. And so you have to kind of doubt the efficacy of the strategy, given that Google, Apple, Microsoft are all banging their heads in to create the best first-party apps for their own platforms that they control. So I don't know if they can really win that battle.
It's sad, really. I mean, because they were, you know, a pioneer. They're all who we all remember using to search the web in the beginning. And then it just seemed like they were so scattered that now they don't have buy-in on anything. You know, the messaging, anything that's important. No, either their cloud service and now media. So really, they had this big spin-off or spin-in plan in December, and now it just seems like we're just waiting for the worst to happen.
Yeah.
Well, it's sad. I mean, layoffs are always a really sad moment. So I don't want to make light of the situation. You know, for Yahoo employees, this is a really tough period, and I hope them all very, very well. I hope Yahoo well, frankly. But I'm with you, Megan. I don't really see the next step.
Well, Alex, thank you so much for joining us to talk about this. I know it was last minute, so I love when you are able to step in to talk about financial stuff and web stuff. And I know you'll be coming on the show in about a month to be our third co-host. So we look forward to talking to you again then.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Alex.
Thank you, Alex.
Alex,
really appreciate it.
Is, of course, the editor-in-chief at Mattermark and at Alex on Twitter.
That's right. next time you're back, you'll be on the full screen here, like 8 minutes right now. Last fall, T-Mobile launched its Binge On program that allows exempted video to be played without hitting the customer's data plan. And there's been a lot of critique from open internet advocates, Google, and the EFF that Binge On is borderline, if not infringing completely on net neutrality rules. John Leisure, outspoken, to say the least, CEO of T-Mobile, took to Twitter today with a video response of those allegations. We actually have a clip of this.
There are people out there saying we're throttling. That's a game of semantics, and it's that's not what we're doing. Really. What throttling is slowing down data and removing customer control. Let me be clear. Binge On is neither of those things. When you stream video from a participating site with Binge On, it never subtracts any data from your plan. And you know what? Mobile customers often don't want or need full, heavy, giant video data files. So we built.
So he goes on a little bit later to say that special interest groups are offended simply to make the news. Like they're basically showing their offense to this to get into the news. He actually later took to Periscope because I guess he was kind of fielding questions on Periscope and answered one of EFF's questions there about if Binge On alters the video stream, and with a follow-up point basically saying, who the bleep are you and who pays you anyways? So he's feeling a little under pressure on this, understandably, I suppose. But I don't know. Where do you stand on this, Nathan? Do you feel like what they're doing is borderline net neutrality infringement, or I don't know. What do you think?
Well, first off, I just think this whole thing is hilarious. The fact that he doesn't know who the EFF is, if he doesn't actually know. I mean, I think he's just making a point.
Yeah.
But the idea that even as a CEO of T-Mobile would even jokingly say that is just hilarious to me, and it just thrills me. But all that aside, all that just like shenanigans aside, I mean, he really knows how to drum up drama, and he likes being this like bombastic personality, and he's getting attention, and he's defending himself. He's thumping his chest. But honestly, I think what they're doing is not right. And I think it is kind of flying in the face of what net neutrality is all about. Really, they're not treating all data the same. They're not treating all providers the same. They do say that any video provider that wants to take part in Binge On can do so if they have the technical abilities. And so far, they're waiting for companies to apply, and they've let in folks like Netflix and Hulu and PlayStation and different cable service providers with their streaming apps. Mm-hmm. So that's fine, but all those companies are massive and they have a lot of money. So if you're just like a small content startup, maybe you're just like a small video streaming startup, maybe you're a startup that has video as a component of your app or something. I mean, the resources you're going to have to match Netflix to get in on this, or the priority that T-Mobile is going to give you to get in on this, I just don't see that happening. And that's where the unfair part comes in. They're not treating all content the same. They're not treating all streaming the same. They're not treating all data the same, right? And that's where the problem is. I mean, he can kind of dance around it, but it's just simple.
Part of his argument has been that it's opt-out, that you have a choice, essentially. Some people are, you know, debating whether it should be opt-in or opt-out. By default, you're opted in on this, and you can opt out if you so choose. So part of what T-Mobile and John are saying in that regard is, well, you have a choice. Therefore, it's not a net neutrality deal. You can choose to not be affected by this. But does that lessen kind of those charges at all, do you think?
Not much to me. Sorry to cut off.
Yeah,
I
just think it's like those companies that don't have the money to be one of those big, you know, streamers, they don't have a choice.
Potentially couldn't participate.
So, yeah, I mean, I think it really has to do with money, and it's confusing. It may be the first test of net neutrality and how consumers are going to really care about it or not, because it's like what they're saying is like, well, if you're a subscriber, you get all this free stuff. Here's all this free stuff. Do you want to take it? And, you know, and that's basically what he's saying. And, you know, of course, we want to stream stuff and not have it, you know, account against, you know, our minutes. So it's, you know, it makes sense from a, you know, I want free stuff, you know, from that end. But really, it's not what net neutrality stands for. I mean, that's what I think.
Do we know that these companies are paying to be involved with Binge On? I'm searching through the kind of the Binge On FAQ, and of course, they aren't going to probably go to their FAQ and be like, and these companies have paid to take part in our program. But I am kind of curious to that aspect of things.
I don't think we know that yet. Okay. I haven't seen it reported anywhere. But T-Mobile itself has said that there's a list of more than 50 companies waiting to take part in Binge On.
Yep.
So that list is growing, and there is a waiting list. I mean, they're simply making choices. And so are they making choices based on people who are paying them? Are they making choices based on, you know, who's already the biggest, you know, bulldog in the room? I don't know. But when you hear folks like Netflix and PlayStation getting in now, and you have to wonder, well, who are those other 50 and that growing list possibly? Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I mean, it's just they're making choices, and that someone's getting picked over someone else.
Sure.
Right. And the promise of the internet is that, you know, we can all create our own content. We can all stream our own content. You know, the best will just rise to the top. That's the promise. And now this isn't, you know, being delivered if they're going to be able to do things like this.
Exactly.
I also think it's interesting what he said about the EFF. You know, like you said, he's like, who are you? You know, it was kind of like a who are
yeah,
you?
Yeah, when you watch it, it's really less of like, I have no idea who these guys are. And it's more like, who do you think you are is probably what he meant to say.
But he also said, like, who pays? He said, who pays you? Which right. I thought that was a good question because I am a supporter of the EFF. Not, I don't donate to the EFF, but I like a lot of what they say. But it is, it's like, oh, well, wait, who does support them? You know, they're donor supported. They're a nonprofit. And they are, you know, some contributors are Google and Mark Cuban. George Hotz, the guy who made the self-driving car in his basement. So it's like there it is. It pays to pay attention to, yes, like when you're talking about a nonprofit who's as big and influential as the EFF is. Yeah, look who donates to them. I totally agree with that. He could have used nicer language when he said that. And also,
yeah, that's not his MO. Nice language is actually part of his spiel.
I would also recommend that he goes through the professional channels rather than Periscopes from now on. That would be my...
Oh, but you know, actually, I actually kind of appreciate that a little bit, right? Like he's so passionate about this, and you see it anytime you see him talk about anything that has anything to do with T-Mobile. Like, passion, he wears it entirely on his sleeve. And he's very active in social media, you know, which puts him kind of in touch with both his fans and T-Mobile's fans and their critics directly. So he's not afraid to get involved, you know, one-on-one with people, and I kind of appreciate that.
Yeah, he's like Elon Musk. He'll tweet anything. And, yeah. You know, you gotta appreciate that.
For sure.
So let's move on. Apple now owns the artificial intelligence technology that some regular people don't even possess, and that's the ability to determine emotions by looking at someone in the face. Now, we don't know why Apple bought this company or what they'll use this technology for. Nate, your paper reported today on Apple's purchase of the artificial intelligence startup Emotient. I think that's how you pronounce it, or maybe Emodient. What can you tell us about this?
Yeah, well, we actually broke that news. It was a scoop by a couple colleagues of mine, three actually, and I'm really proud of that. But yeah, basically, this is a startup that is using kind of artificial intelligence, deep learning sort of technology to analyze facial expressions. And there's some speculation that Apple might try and apply this to maybe things that relate to, say, FaceTime or to maybe camera technology and things like that. And that could make some sense. But it was really, I think, kind of an interesting move when you put it in context with, say, Facebook or Google, who are also investing a lot in artificial intelligence and who are doing a lot with image recognition and facial recognition. Mm-hmm. Facebook and Google right now are the biggest places for people to store their photos. No offense to Flickr out there. That's kind of dwindling a little bit. But one of the things that both Google and Facebook do a really good job with is taking the photos, using facial recognition and allowing you to be able to search through your photos a lot quicker. I don't think this is obviously just a play just for iPhoto, but that combining the PhotoMight plus artificial intelligence is a really compelling concept. And I think that's what they're after.
Yeah, it is. It's interesting. I mean, you could use this in so many ways. And, you know, just when you brought up Facebook, and that's the thing, they have our face print. That's what they call it, a face print. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, this idea of like, is that something personal? Is that something we should be, keeping private, like a password? Like what, I mean, obviously you can't bring, the cat is out of the bag on there. Like you see people's face, but it is weird. Like, what are they going to use it for?
Maybe on the OS level, they'll try and tackle what Google did, tried, and I'm not sure that they've succeeded completely with some sort of like security based around facial features. Although I think the fingerprint kind of sensor that we're seeing all over mobile devices right now kind of tackles that. But Apple is very much, it's in their playbook to take something that's maybe a neat idea but didn't quite work so well, retool it, invest in it, and make it something that actually really shines. So who knows? Maybe on an OS level, you could do some really cool things like that.
Right, but you could also do some scary things, right? Because it's not just your face. It's like whether you like something or not. So in terms of advertising, like I don't want to be watching my Apple TV and have them say like, oh, she really liked that ad for whatever. Like maybe I'm smiling at something else, or maybe I don't want them to know, that I like that. So yeah, I think it's one thing to have just your face, but then this seems to be taking it one step further. Like what, how do you feel about something?
I don't know, beta testing. It could be really valuable for beta testing, actually. read the facial expression on the user and know that, wow, that was not a good idea. Let's strip that out of the next release.
Right. I guess what I'm kind of, thinking about in my head is how this could fit in with things that already exist, like Siri, or like, OS X, like you're talking about, or OS X. You know, Windows 10 has the ability to let you log into a computer with your face, and that's something that OS 10 doesn't have quite yet. Mm-hmm. And just, you know, making Siri like a more real, actual artificial intelligence, you know, assistant, rather than something that just pops up and gives you, you know, web search queries. What if at some point it can interpret how you're feeling, or, you know, what you're thinking, or whether you like something or not? That's there both terrifying is. And super exciting.
There it is. I think, yes. I like to believe that you just nailed it on that one.
Yeah.
Instead of Siri cool. just being a personal assistant, Siri is actually your friend that I mean, sometimes you have to cry into their shoulder. And yeah, totally. I see it.
Is that where all the science fiction goes?
Yes. You know?
And then last year, this is something that we reported in our story. Last year, Apple also bought another artificial intelligence startup called Vocal IQ. And what they would do was basically just work on improving a computer's ability to understand your natural speech patterns. So whether you're excited or stressed or, you know, happy or sad or whatever. So there's some interesting things happening here. And then we also reported that Apple picked up this company for a relative bargain. They've only raised about $8 million from investors. Intel was one of their investors, and they've had a hard time raising more money. So they're in a little bit of, I guess, kind of a challenging position, and it seems like Apple was able to maybe possibly pick them up on the cheap.
Yeah. As Beatmaster in the chat room says, and I like to believe this could be a future reality, Siri, I need a hug.
There you go.
There we go. It could happen. It could happen. Rideshare businesses like Uber and Lyft are being blamed, at least partially, for San Francisco's largest taxi cab company, Yellow Cab, nearing a filing for Chapter 11 bankruptcy. Yellow Cab says that ridership, well, they say ridership is strong, but that they're forced to do more with less. That's kind of what they're telling their shareholders. But sources are saying that rideshare companies are actually drawing away business, but not only just business, riders or drivers, talented drivers from their fleets. When you take Uber's fleet in San Francisco, if you want to call it a fleet of Uber cars, 16,000 Uber cars, which that's a number that just kind of blew me away when I read that, weekly versus Yellow Cab's 530 medallion holding drivers. Like, that's a force that is just next to impossible to defend. I mean, the number of taxi cab companies in a city like San Francisco, which is a very taxi, you know, taxi friendly area. A lot of people take their taxi cabs. New York, obviously, much bigger number there. But and then you compare it to 16,000. Like, that's hard to compete with. I don't know. What do you think? What do you guys think about this? That's impressive.
I actually am hoping that this will be really good. You know, I use Lyft, I use Uber, and I do use taxis, and I do feel for all those taxi drivers out there that have basically been kind of, you know, displaced, so to speak, and seen their business go down. But the whole token system just seems like a really old, you know, just kind of, you know, open to corruption kind of setup. I mean, basically, there are these tokens that are granted out by the city or whatever. And then, you know, the cab companies own those. And then in order to drive, you have to have a token and you can't get one on your own. And it's just like this really ridiculous system. And essentially what Uber and Lyft have done is just said, if you have a car, we'll connect you with a driver or with a rider. And there you go. And that's just a much more simple way to do it. So my hope is that Yellow Cab and maybe the entire taxi industry will reevaluate this whole concept of tokens and the way that they do things. Because the simple fact is that, you know, taxi drivers have been treated like crap by a lot of taxi companies for decades. And taxi companies have never really given that great a service to riders for decades. And it's also not the cheapest way to get around. So here's this outside thing that's challenging it. Now we're seeing it struggle. Now they're filing for bankruptcy here in San Francisco. My hope is that it'll be an opportunity to reevaluate some things and in some relief from bankruptcy, kind of restructure some things. But I mean, that's just kind of like me daydreaming. I don't have any reason to think that would actually happen, but God, wouldn't that be nice?
But yeah, it's a force to be reckoned with.
I mean, I think that I totally agree with you. The medallion system is backward and it doesn't work. And if you talk to Uber drivers, most of them were cab drivers before, and most of them will say, this is so much better for me. But at the same time, Uber is playing fast and loose with the, you know, employees or not employees whole thing. And, and you know, the report about why they're going out of business, it's not just Uber. Like, they had huge debts. And some of it was Uber, but some of it was insurance. And this gets back to what Uber can do, because Yellow Cab had to pay for an accident. They were sued because the driver was considered an employee when it came down to it. And so they had to pay much more money than they had the insurance for. And so, like, that's what a lot of these debts are. So it gets back to that, you know, are these Uber drivers really protected in the way that they need to be? What I think about this is there needs to just be a different level of employee. It's no longer just like you're a contractor or you're a full-time employee with the right, you know, the sharing economy. There's another layer in there that I think that we have to create. And I mean, I'm not an economist or a lawmaker, but I do think that there seems to be just another place where another kind of employee that needs to be treated in some ways the same as full-time employees. In some way, this is the same as contractors.
Mm-hmm. That's fascinating, Megan. I mean, I don't know if you've thought about this that much, but what would that look like? Because to me right now, if you're a full-time employee, hopefully anyways, you have health insurance, and you know, the company, let's say in this case, you know, the cab company is supplying the car, and if you get an accident, their insurance covers it. Where with Uber, there are zero safety nets. There's no 401ks. There is no health insurance. There are no vacation days. There is no time off. What would that like middle ground employee look like? I love the concept, but I wonder if you've thought about that at all.
I have thought about it. I don't really know what it would look like. I just know from being a contractor and being a full-time employee, but you know, I've never driven a taxi or an Uber. So I don't exactly know how it would look like, but I just know when I first started to think about this, I was just like, Uber drivers need, you know, they need time off and you know, they need health insurance and they need to, you know, all these things. And then when I started talking to them, when I was taking Uber, I like this. I like the flexibility. I have more money than I can pay for my own health insurance. You know, they're just, it's not as simple. And yeah, I don't have an answer.
I wish I had.
Yeah, definitely something needs to be done.
Absolutely. All right, let's take a quick minute here and we'll thank the first sponsor of this episode. And that is Epson. You know Epson. Epson's revolutionary EcoTank line of printers for home and office introduced a new age in printing. This is kind of what we've always wanted right here. This is the new EcoTank ET4550. It's a wireless all-in-one printer. Doesn't use ink cartridges. Instead, it features an innovative refillable ink tank. So you're not buying cartridges to, you know, plug in there. You run out of the cartridge, get a new cartridge and everything. It's an ink tank for all the colors. Fill them up as you need. It comes with enough ink to print up to 8,500 pages, equivalent to about 50 ink cartridge sets. You're loaded and ready to print for up to 2 years. Powered by Epson's leading edge precision core technology, it delivers high speed, vivid colors, laser quality black text, plus auto two-sided printing, 30-page auto document feeder, and easy wireless printing from tablets and from smartphones. And I've tried that with other printers, and it's not always so easy. They make it easy here with the Epson EcoTank printers. All EcoTank printers deliver an unbeatable combination of convenience and value with ultra-low-cost replacement ink bottles. Now you have the freedom to print without running out of ink. And like I said, the ET4550, that's 11,000 black pages in those ink cartridges that ship with it. 8,500 color pages ship with are capable of printing that coming in the box when you get the package. It's about the same as 50 ink cartridges, which is just totally awesome. Visit Epson.com/EcoTank today to transform the way your home office or workgroup prints. For the best combination of ease and value, turn to the new Epson EcoTank printers. That's EPSON.com/EcoTank. And we thank Epson for their support. Epson, exceed your vision. CES is still happening.
It is still happening.
Still.
It is time to check in with our intrepid reporters who are braving the onslaught of dumb, smart technology at CES.
It's a good combination, I think, dumb and smart.
We have Father Robert Ballecer. You're on the show floor behind what is possibly my favorite CES announcement. What have you seen? what is that you're standing in front of?
Well, Megan, Jason, I'm coming to you from CES, from the drone pavilion. I think it's the angriest sounding place on earth. But yeah, you're right. This is the EHang 184, the drone that if you're brave enough, will take you up to 2 miles away in 23 minutes.
So what do you think, Father Robert Ballecer? Are you brave enough to hop in there right now and see if you can get it to take off before someone tries to eject you from the seat?
I actually tried it, and they told me, please don't do that again, so I'm not going to try it again.
Dang, and you didn't have the camera rolling. We gotta work on this a little bit.
So did someone controlling it with, like, their iPhone? How is this working?
Yeah, no, so the way that it works is it's completely autonomous. You don't actually have any pilot controls in the cabin. You set your destination, you power it on. There's two buttons. You power it on, and you hit flight. It does an automated takeoff and landing at your destination. It does all the collision avoidance. And in fact, while you've been doing your A-spot, we've been watching all the B-roll, showing us the testing and how they've gone through the various development stages of the 184, showing different rotor configurations. And actually, it's a fascinating story. Wow. This product isn't just a flight of fancy. They've put some serious engineering time behind it.
So,
there are no, like, even emergency controls in there, like, just on a, like, worst case scenario, and, you know, you lose that LTE connection or whatever it is. I mean, there's nothing. There's absolutely nothing in there. There's nothing.
Well, it's built into the smart. So the way that they say it is that it does all the collision avoidance, and they've actually tested this. They've got video of them putting it into different circumstances to try to fool it, and they think they've got that bug worked out. The other part is, if the system detects a problem, let's say the batteries are starting to fail, or it's starting to lose a rotor, or starting to lose lift, or it can't fight the headwinds, it will automatically touch down, and it will touch down in a safe spot. So, yeah, it's kind of scary. I mean, it's the same idea of having a driverless car. The first time you get in it, you're going to think, I want to be able to get myself out of trouble. But statistically, we make way worse decisions than the computer will.
Well, so you're in the drone pavilion, and I know you also saw the drone that had wings instead of propellers. And we talked about that with Lindsay from CNET. But what did you think of it?
Yes, that's the Parrot Disco. At first, I thought it was a step back, because I like multi-rotor craft. I like multi-rotor craft. I like the ability to have a stable flight. But what the Parrot Disco did was it gave us much more flight time. Whereas you could get maybe 10, 20 minutes out of a multi-rotor craft, you could get 45 minutes out of the Parrot Disco, a fixed wing. And it also meant that you could get these beautiful swooping shots. Imagine the best scene from Star Wars, where you're coming up over hills and over snow-covered mountains. That's the kind of footage you can get out of a disco versus a multi-rotor. So it's not going to replace the multi-rotor, but I think it's definitely a compliment.
And so what are some of the other things that you have seen that you've liked?
Okay, I know I'm going to take some heat for this, but the number one product, the one that I actually will spend my own money when I get home and I'm ready to make the pre-order, it's the Razer Blade Stealth. It's a 2.75-pound ultrabook. Now, when I say ultrabook, that doesn't do it justice. It is a beautifully styled aluminum case. It has a 12.6-inch 4K screen, 8 gigabytes of memory, comes with an i7 processor. It's a gaming ultrabook. It's designed to let you game, so it has enough power, and up to a 512-gigabyte SSD, and it's only $1,000. I mean, most of those ultrabooks start between $1,500 and $2,500, so I have no idea how they hit that price point. Oh, it also has an individually illuminated keyboard, so that as you switch from game to game, you can illuminate just the keys that you use for that particular game.
Nice.
And here's my personal favorite. It's got Thunderbolt and two USB 3. The Thunderbolt port can connect to the Razer Core. It's an enclosure that allows you to put in a desktop video card. So this laptop will never go obsolete, at least not for a very long time. As graphic technology increases, you pop in a new graphics card, you're good to go.
And so, speaking of Bolt, we talked a little bit about the Bolt, the full electric car, yesterday. We thought it was no Tesla, and it was still $30,000 for a car that didn't look as pretty as some might have liked. But we like the range, and there was also what we didn't mention yesterday. There's like a gamification to kind of see like who can get the best range out of their electric car. Did you take a look at that?
Yes, absolutely. Now, you got to remember, GM is the company that killed the electric car. And so the fact that they've come back after the moderate failure of the Volt, and they've come back with an all-electric car with a design that's actually pretty decent, it says a lot. Now, what I like about the Bolt is, as you mentioned, it's got that 200-mile range. It's $30,000 after you take away all the tax credits. But that gamification aspect that you mentioned, I think that's going to be more important than everything else. That's what made the Prius succeed, because it made you want to drive better. It made you want to modify your driving habits. And ultimately, you can have the most advanced vehicle that there is, but if you don't drive it properly, you won't get the fuel economy. What GM has done with the Bolt is they've given you that incentive. You want to set the high score, and I mean, who doesn't want to be the best driver of their circle of friends?
So can I compare myself with, like, you know, the Tesla that Leo's going to buy if I had the Bolt, or is it just with other people driving a Bolt?
Well, consider this. For the price of a Tesla, you can almost buy three Bolts. So either buy a Tesla or pick up a three-pack of Bolts.
Okay. A blister pack of Bolts.
Your scores, right?
Exactly.
So, you know, we've talked a little bit this week about security, specifically in Internet of Things. I know there's been a lot of talk. There was a lot of talk last year also about Internet of Things security, and it seems like not a lot has changed. You went to a session about security with Brian Krebs, Krebs on Security. What can you tell us about that?
Right. There was the first ever cybersecurity conference here at CES. Now, I have to mention, it was interesting. They had an earlier session in which Edward Snowden came in via a telepresence unit. He was on a beam unit from Adequate Technologies. And one of the things he said was he likes the technology being released, the fact that everything is connected, but he wishes there was more attention being paid in the design phase to actually working security in. And that's exactly what that cybersecurity forum was all about. In fact, you had Krebs, Brian Krebs from Krebs on Security. He echoed something that the chairwoman of the FTC said back in September in San Francisco, and that is, if we're going to grow the Internet of Things, if we're going to have these sensors that can take data on our environment in every part of our lives, we need to start thinking of security as part of the design, not something that we lump in after there've been a breach. And so I think, hopefully, this will be a kickoff of the new Internet of Things. On This Week in Enterprise Tech, we call it the Internet of Hacked Things. Maybe now we can have the Internet of Secure Things.
One would hope.
Yeah, I mean, that ties right into yesterday's story with the Comcast Xfinity kind of flaws, and just the fact that Comcast is refusing to take, you know, ownership of that specifically, because it's more of an industry standard sort of thing than it is a Comcast specific thing. And it's kind of surprising when you're talking about Internet of Things, because many times it is all about security, yet not so secure.
So the Edwards...
Exactly. And actually, at Black Hat this year, last year, the keynote speaker, he said something very interesting. I think it's germane to this, which is we're starting to realize that we're protecting all of our servers. We're protecting the infrastructure of the Internet. But especially with the Internet of Things, if I can own 10 million devices, I don't care about the servers in the middle. I don't care about the infrastructure. I can take everything down without ever touching a single server on the core. So that's part of that focus of the Internet of Things. It's a recognition that the power, the importance has shifted from being a castle in the middle of a moat to protecting every little vessel and vassal and village along the way.
So I want to get back to the Edward Snowden appearing by robot, by telepresence robot. I mean, are we to assume that, I guess they have pretty good security, otherwise he wouldn't have used them and people could find out where he was, right? I mean, is that what we're supposed to learn from this?
Well, actually, the NSA came and they arrested the robot. So I think that's the end of that.
They handcuffed the robot to the bike the bike mount outside, and it could go no further. I do think it's funny that that Edward Snowden is becoming the face of telepresence just in general. He's like, see, right. If it works for me, it can work for you.
Yeah, or maybe for wanted men and women.
Yes.
There's a whole industry here of just putting Edward Snowden on a green screen and just making him a pop up anywhere you want.
Exactly. Snowden on demand.
Well, Robert, thank you so much for joining us, and I know you'll still have more things to report from CES, so we look forward to talking to you again, and there's lots of specials. You're on pretty much for many hours of the day, so we look forward to seeing everything else that you have to show us.
Thank you to the both of you, and good luck with the rest of TNT. As soon as we turn off this camera, I'm going to try to jump back into the 184.
Okay, do it. But don't turn off the camera. That's the problem. Keep it rolling. Keep it rolling. Have fun, and don't get sick. All right. We got an email to TNT at twit.tv from Jim, who wrote in about a big consideration when it comes to Microsoft's support of legacy versions of Internet Explorer that we talked about yesterday. He says, I spoke with some friends who work for the largest insurance company in the world, and some of them are still using IE version 9, while others have version 11. XP only went away recently. The problem is that some of the large companies have applications that rest on the old platforms, cost a lot of money to change. It's very common for the older version to linger on. And that's absolutely a consideration here. One thing to know is that this nag that's going to appear after this update can actually be removed if you're willing to go into the registry and make the change. So any institutions that are still running on kind of older systems that don't want to see that anymore and just want to continue on doing what they're doing, they can get around it if they need to. But yeah, I mean, that's a huge consideration, right? It's the reason why so many companies lingered on Windows XP for as long as they did, because things were built around it. It just worked the way that they expected it to and that it needed to do for business to be business as usual. And any change is potentially, a big cost and just a big pain.
Yeah, Nathan, you said you still run Windows 7 at work too.
Unfortunately, the work issued computer that I get from my news organization, the Wall Street Journal, is running Windows 7, and it pains me every day to look at that instead of Windows 10. But just as you guys just said, we have things that work with it. In fact, we had some VPN software with some security measures that did not work on Windows 8, and so far don't work on Windows 10. Microsoft is actually not secure enough in their new operating systems for what we want. So I'm still running Windows 7, and you know what? I don't use Internet Explorer 9. I don't use Internet Explorer 10. I don't actually use Internet Explorer at all. I use Chrome and Firefox. And I mean, I don't know. When I hear people complain about this, I'm just like, upgrade. Just use a different browser or whatever. I mean, not to talk smack against anyone out there, but if you're not willing to spend the money to give your employees the tools necessary to do their job in a safe way, then, I mean, what the hell are you doing? Right now we're using Windows 7. It still works and it is safe and we're able to do all of the things we need to do. But I hope that if it ever got to a point, and I believe that it would, that if we needed to upgrade an operating system or a browser or whatever to do what we need to do safely, that we would handle it. And I don't know. I just, all of these complaints, just, it's like, what are you doing still using Internet Explorer 9? I mean, just, I have a hard time fathoming that.
Change is hard.
It is,
I think.
Hard. And we talked about like an enterprise tablet recently that, it was just a brand new tablet. It's going to run Windows 8. It's not going to run Windows 10 because it's for the enterprise. So I think,
right.
Everyone understands that.
Yeah, fair enough. All right, let's take another minute. Thank the second sponsor of this episode, and that is ZipRecruiter. If you're hiring, you're not sure where to find the best candidates, that's what ZipRecruiter is kind of all about. As a business owner, your company is only as good as the people that you hire. Posting jobs in one place isn't enough to find quality candidates, and short staffing leaves little time to post to dozens of job sites. I definitely know that through my wife, who owns her own business. It's not easy. Feels like there are a million places to submit, to search, and doing that on your own simply eats up your time. Time that can be better spent running the business. Thanks to ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100 plus job sites with one single click, and be instantly matched to candidates from over nearly 6 million resumes. A ton of resumes. Just post once and within 24 hours, watch your candidates roll in, and you can now try it for free for yourself to check it out, see what you think. Getting the right people for your company is so important. In fact, here's Dan. He's a happy ZipRecruiter client who said, the hardest part about running a business when you need to hire is that you have to spend extra time recruiting while you're short-staffed. But with ZipRecruiter, I've gotten quality candidates within 24 hours of posting a job. ZipRecruiter's website makes this process so much faster by letting me manage candidates in one place. That's exactly what makes ZipRecruiter such an indispensable service for your business. Today, you can try ZipRecruiter for free. Go to ziprecruiter.com/TNT. That's ziprecruiter.com/TNT and check it out for yourself. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of Tech News Today.
Next is a segment that we like to call the blurbs. These are just some quick check-ins with the stories. And Nathan, you can weigh in if you want. And if we've said everything perfectly that there needs to be said about this story, you can feel free not to weigh in.
Our first, to you.
Our first story is about Time Warner. Time Warner Cable says that up to 320,000 customers' data may have been stolen, but not necessarily from them. Reuters reports that the FBI notified Time Warner that customer emails and passwords had been compromised, but Time Warner says there's no evidence that their own systems have been hacked. Instead, the company believes the addresses and password leaks are a result of phishing attacks on customers or data breaches at other customers, at other companies. So, yeah, I mean, a lot of our passwords and a lot of our usernames are already out there, sadly.
I'm kind of numb at this point, to be honest. Like, I hear about them all, and I know that I should, like, be worried, but maybe I shouldn't be. I don't know.
Well, you should change
this,
your password.
I'm just numb at this point.
You should regularly change your password.
Yeah. Well, that's why I use a password manager. Although, yeah, I could probably use it a little better than I do. Motorola, the hot potato of tech that was bought by Lenovo in 2014 from Google, is about to get a name change. Lenovo is unifying its phone business, and as a result, new Motorola phones, which will now be Lenovo's high-end devices, will carry the simpler Moto branding, basically putting to bed a name that once embodied wireless technology. Motorola, just the name itself has been such a big name in the development of technology in the past 20 years, wireless tech, all that kind of stuff. And now Motorola as a name is just kind of going away. It's kind of a sad day in that regard, I suppose.
I feel nostalgic. I feel like this sucks. It really hurts. But like you said, Motorola has been around for so long.
Yeah.
But I feel like it's the kind of thing where it could go away for, 5-10 years, and then they'll bring it back, and it'll like have kind of like a vintage thing. I mean, we're gonna get to that point with smartphones. I mean, I'm a sneakerhead. I love Air Jordans. They're shoes I couldn't have when I was a kid. Now, like an idiot, I buy 5 pairs of the same shoe in different colors. And there's a lot of people who really, really want the little Nike Air logo on the back, because they stopped putting the Nike Air logo on the back in the 90s. And then it was just the Jumpman logo since then. And now they're bringing it back and they're charging like an extra $50 for it. And I have not bought any of those, but a lot of people do. I feel like this is going to be something. It's going to go away and then they're going to bring it back at some point, right? I mean, maybe, 3 different companies will have owned Motorola by then, but I don't know. Am I crazy? Or
I can see the name coming back. I often wonder if technology will get a retro kind of resurgence. And it seems to happen a little bit on like video game consoles. Every once in a while you'll see like, oh, there's an old Super Nintendo, but it runs, new things or whatever. I sometimes wonder if that'll ever happen with things like cell phones, because we are so close to them and we identify with them so closely. But then I remember that Zach Morris had the gigantic cell phone from years and years ago on Saved by the Bell. That's a reference that only some of you are even going to understand.
Yeah. Start
exactly. Yeah. And I'm like, no, I don't think we're ever going back there. So there's retro qualities in technology in some ways, possibly with the Motorola name. And I could totally see it in an old Coke, new Coke sort of way.
Right.
But yeah, maybe not the technology itself.
But cell phone size, like, that varies. We go the first iPhones were tiny and now they're huge, but like now we want them smaller.
I know, right? They're all over the place. Yeah. We can't make up our minds.
I wouldn't mind a giant. Yeah. And then there was a Windows. It was called the Pixie. It's like a Windows tablet from CES, but it's this big. And so it's like a small tablet, but a big phone, So there's that.
There's the Zach Morris with the brick phone.
What about something like the Razer coming back with like 2 touchscreens in like a few years? I mean, I don't know. Okay, this is crazy. Now I'm just like throwing things out, but I think people could be into that. I mean, there is some sort of retro appeal there. Like you said, cassettes are making a comeback.
Yeah.
Some people still buy vinyl records and turntables.
True.
There's a lot of old school things that still, linger around, but you're right. I mean, the phone is the thing you have on you all the time. It's a lot different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. The Sidekick is interesting too, because that was something that just, I'm too old for Sidekick. So now when like a Sidekick gets retro, I feel really old, sadly.
Yeah.
So let's move on to Facebook. Facebook's head of messaging used the Facebook Notes tool to spread a message of hope today, hope that everyone in the world would give up their old-fashioned SMS messaging and take all their conversations to Facebook Messenger instead. The company now has 800 million users on Messenger alone. They introduced a slew of new features this year, but I am not ready to give up on the simplicity of just the old-fashioned text messaging. Are you guys ready for that?
No. Yeah, not at all.
Do you use Facebook Messenger?
I use it a lot, and I really hate using it, but there's so many people that I know that do use it. But it, you know, just like both Messenger and Google Hangouts, when people message me in them, I don't get the notifications as quick as I need to, and the app doesn't load as fast as I'd like. I mean, the fastest, easiest, best performing thing is text messages. It's MMS and it's SMS, and it's not this proprietary stuff. So I mean, I'm not ready to take that leap and go full Facebook, but of course Facebook wants you to do that. I mean, you know, I'm not surprised by that at all.
Yeah, that's their business.
Yeah, I mean, I still love the simplicity of the text message, because that's what Facebook is saying. Like, oh, you can use GIFs and you can send money and you can do all these things. And I just like the simplicity of it. And I mean, I think they're just planning more. There was another story we didn't get to yesterday because we had too many stories. But sources say that Facebook is allowing some developers access to the chat SDK. They're going to build bots into Messenger for shopping and booking and travel and more. I mean, basically, they want all the services moved away from apps and into Facebook, because then they win the war.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this whole chatbot thing is getting really fascinating, and it was really starting to kind of seem like 2016, you know, there's going to be a couple of recurring themes all the way through. Seems like, you know, chatbots is near the top of that list as just kind of an effort that we're going to see a lot more of. And it's an interesting kind of turn away from something that we've been obsessed with, at least in mobile, for the last however many years, which are apps. And now it's like services inside an app that, you know, mm-hmm. maybe that doesn't belong to the business that's providing that service, but it's still, you know, there's incentive enough apparently to do that, and also cross-platform, like possibly over, you know, across multiple different chat clients, having the single service that hits them all. Yeah, it's really interesting. I jury's still out on whether I'm going to get used to using them in the way that they're being designed, but you know, there's a whole generation that's growing up with this stuff right now, and that's not going to seem weird to them.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, in Asia, like WeChat and different mm-hmm. apps are very popular in this way. People are using Android phones, but they go into that one messaging app, and then they're sending money, they're, you know, looking for restaurants, they're playing games, they're doing all these different things. And just like what you said, it's kind of like a pendulum swing. You know, for a while, Facebook was pushing, breaking all of its apps into separate things. Like, do you guys remember when Messenger was a part of Facebook?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And so now they're trying to break all those things out. Now they're trying to slowly bring those things back. And what it kind of reminds me of is what they did when they first launched their whole timeline concept, back in 2012, 2011. And they wanted to have links into, like, Netflix and, you know, when you're listening to this song in Spotify, it'll show up on your timeline, and then your friends will know you're listening to, and you can take part. And none of that ever really took off. They also tried to have like a, you know, a shopping section inside of Facebook to kind of compete with Amazon to a certain extent. That didn't really take off. I know they were selling like Tide detergent for a while and stuff like that. This is kind of following what is popular in Asia with a few apps, and it's also building on the success. Now you have 800 million people using Messenger. Why not try and leverage that user base when you have all these people's attention? It's a gamble, but if Facebook can pull it off, you know, they might be able to look a little smart and get ahead of the curve before those apps that are popular in Asia maybe come over here into the United States and catch on and do the same thing. But I mean, me personally, it's just another layer. It's like, what's the difference of going into one app and seeing a bunch of icons versus just looking at my home screen and seeing the icons I want?
Yeah.
Do you think they're aiming at people whose only computer is a smartphone?
No question. I mean, just like you said, there are a lot of folks who are growing up and this doesn't seem weird to them. But then you also look at emerging markets, and people are mobile first, not because, you know, they're out in front of some Silicon Valley trend. They're mobile first because they have to be, because they don't have a laptop at their disposal or a desktop or whatever. This is the way that they live and work. And this is kind of a reflection of that to a certain extent, but it's also a way for Facebook to try and get this power and lure in developers. I mean, you know, they were trying to have that Facebook Home layer over the top of Android. And there's been talk of them, you know, of course, you know, making their own mobile operating system. Those rumors have kind of died down over the last few years. But, you know, they've experimented with the Facebook One phone and different things like that. They want to be as big and as powerful as Google and Apple and Microsoft. And if they're going to stick around for a long, long, long time, they need to be the center of your life in the way that those other companies are. And this makes sense as a way for them to do that if they can pull it off. But they need to be kind of exploring that way to be the backbone of your digital existence. And this is a very smart way to do it. I mean, even if it doesn't work out, they need to take this risk and try and make it happen.
One thing that Facebook does, they definitely try things and then kill them. You know what I mean? Like, if it doesn't work out, they'll kill it. So they aren't afraid to do that. And they have such a, you know, as a prior host of this very show, Mike Elgin has said many times, you know, they have a monopoly on people. And that's a perfect way to put it. And that's why the three of us, I think, as far as I can tell, begrudgingly use, to a certain degree, Messenger and Facebook, because everybody's there. It's kind of the what you have to do, because that's what other people are doing, you know?
No question. Facebook is the social networking app. It's the website. It's the everything digital that I least enjoy using the most, and that I use probably the most because I have to. It's a part of my job, and it's where all of my friends and family are. And I do it, and every day I grit my teeth and I do it.
Well, which do you enjoy the most?
I actually really enjoy Twitter. And, you know, I guess it's probably a nerdy super journalist thing to say. And I'm terrified of this concept of them losing that 140 character limit and going now to 10,000. I don't know if you guys talked about that in other episodes this week, but I love Twitter because it's just so short and so concise. And it's just kind of a fun place to be. And I just feel like Facebook, just there's just so much going on and they're just trying to throw so many different things at you all of the time. It's overwhelming.
Right. And I think they have, I mean, you know, they have amazing designers. You know, it's not like, oh, you know, we just hire people that don't know how to design and it's so cluttered. It's cluttered on purpose. So you get confused and you buy things. That's how it works.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Like Amazon or like any, you know, shopping mall or anything like that. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So chatbots, definitely a theme in 2016. Also another theme, and we're already, you know, we've already talked about it many times on this show, drones. As of this morning, 181,061 drone owners have registered with the Federal Aviation Administration as part of the new requirement for owners to register or face penalties if caught flying without. The deadline for registration before penalties are enforceable is February 19th, though pro tip, register before January 20th and avoid a $5 fee. There you go. So I don't know. Is that a big number? I mean, I feel like there are so many drone owners at this point. That number seems ridiculously small.
It still seems like a lot this far. I mean, I don't know. Have you guys seen commercials or billboards saying register your drone?
No, that's true. Like, that's very, very good point. Yeah.
I feel like the only ones who I've been talking about this with are, you know, like the other nerdy journalists I know who are interested in drones and a few of my friends. It's pretty much just word of mouth. So I guess 180,000 this early in the year seems pretty good to me, but you're right. I mean, there's probably a lot more that they have to get out there.
There is after Christmas anyways.
Yeah. I mean, there's super steep fines if you don't register. Yeah. And people have privacy concerns. I was listening to Patrick Norton, our old coworker, and he was just like, I don't want to register because then my address is public and people can know if I have drones. I probably have other expensive things and they'll come rob me. I don't know if that's tinfoil hat Patrick or real smart Patrick, because they're both. But I think it's good to consider these things.
Mm-hmm. It is good to consider those things, but I also really think, I mean, given that drone technology is growing so fast and that it can be so creepy and, you know, privacy encroaching, and also just potentially dangerous if people don't know how to fly these things, especially the larger ones, right? The larger and heavier ones. I like the idea of a drone registry of drones not getting into the wrong hands or something like that per se. But yeah, I mean, there's got to be a way that we can do that and protect the actual owner's privacy as well, right? Maybe the system isn't perfect, but it seems like a good place to start. Although those civil fines of up to $27,000 are so high. Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are. I mean, I don't think the system's perfect, and I do think they have a lot. They had a lot of smart people, like drone enthusiasts, working on it. But yeah, I don't think it's perfect yet. But it's new. So.
So. It's a start.
Yeah, it is a good start. Jason, you may want to rethink your disdain for Bluetooth headphones. I know we talked about it the other day. You don't like the wireless headphones. But a report today.
Not for me.
Not for you. And it's okay because you don't use an iPhone yet. Fast Company says in order to make the next iPhone thinner, Apple will get rid of the headphone jack. That's a rumor we've been hearing now. Apparently, it's true. We haven't heard from Apple yet, but this is according to sources who say the iPhone 7 will also support wireless charging. It might be waterproof. You'll still be able to, of course, connect to sound if you don't want to use wireless headphones. The Lightning port will be how you connect to that. So get yourself some adapters. Thank you, Apple. The same sources say the new audio system will also use a new noise-canceling technology from Wolfson Microelectronics.
That's a lot of leaked features. I'm curious to know how many of those are true.
They would be great if they
I feel like when they're stacked like that and it's like, and then it'll do this amazing and this amazing and this amazing, then you're probably looking at one or two maybe out of a total of five. But we'll see.
The waterproof thing, I mean, the iPhone 6S is essentially waterproof. They just don't say it. I mean, the Apple Watch is also waterproof. I've tested it all the time. But they don't want to say that. So that's not that exciting to people. Wireless charging.
Wireless charging is pretty awesome. You know what else is awesome? The next bit, Robin. It's the cloud-centric Android mobile phone that was launched successfully on Kickstarter late last year. It's nearing its scheduled release, though early Kickstarter backers, and that includes myself and Leo, will have to wait a few extra weeks. The release date is pushing back from the beginning of February to February 16th. This phone does some really cool things. I don't know if you heard much about this, Megan, but basically they try and give you more or less unlimited storage because they use the cloud to kind of sync the things that you're not using, apps, data, all that kind of stuff, up to the cloud automatically. And then on demand, you can bring it back down when you need more space or you want to actually use that app and all that kind of stuff. I am on the pre-order list or the early backer list, so I will get a unit and we will definitely show it off on this show when I get it.
I like that idea because, I mean, obviously you can use any phone, you know, you can use lots of cloud services, but automatically is nice.
Yeah, it just kind of puts it up there and, yeah, it's done really well. I got to play around with one of the devices on All About Android at the end of last year. And, yeah, it's a really cool phone.
Yeah, because
very different design, too.
I tried it last fall and I really, really liked it. And I thought the company's approach to Android and what they're doing with the cloud was really, really smart. And it's just like, it's so nice to see a phone that doesn't look like everything else that's out there.
Yeah.
You know, just like the bright colors are fresh and the kind of industrial design and, you know, it's a really, really good looking a phone. It's pretty cool to see so many different options out there at a really affordable price points. I mean, with what Robin's doing and OnePlus and, you know, the affordable phones that Motorola is making so far anyways, there's a lot of really great stuff happening on Android and the Nexus phones too, at a you know fairly affordable entry point kind of price wise. But yeah, I'm really looking forward to the Rob, and I liked it when I got to demo it last year.
Well, we have one more quick follow-up. Yesterday, we talked about the cost of the Oculus Rift. We didn't mention the bundles that include an Oculus Ready PC and a Rift. Those will be available for pre-order in February starting at $1,499. That's $1,499. So it's a good option. I mean, I think we talked about like how expensive it is to have a PC that runs, but they are offering that, which is great. I mean, some people will build their own. But if you don't want to, you know, $1,499 for the Rift and the PC that runs the Rift, the Oculus Ready PC.
Awesome.
Yeah. We had another quick follow-up to that story. Palmer Luckey admits to botching pricing PR when he said that it would be more in the ballpark of $350. And a lot of people said that $600 is not in the ballpark. But he said
not remotely.
He was trying to defend himself. So, you know, I'm a fan of Palmer Luckey.
He's a nice guy.
Yeah.
Good guy. Yeah.
All right, so we've kind of fallen out of the habit, or rather this was something that was done on kind of the previous incarnation of this show. Want to continue the tradition of showing off the TNT fan of the day because, well, you are very cool. Robert Sospiro reached out to me on Google+ saying how I watch TNT, Nexus 6P, right on, Chromecast, 75-inch TV, and pajamas. I don't know what that face is that I'm doing, but I must be saying something strange. Show us how you watch or listen to TNT. Just record a video, take a picture of yourself or your setup, whatever you got. Post it on Instagram, Google+, Twitter, or Facebook. You can use the hashtag HowIWatchTNT, all one word, and we're going to find it. We're gonna hunt it down, and we're going to play it on the show and show it off for you.
So let's take a minute now to thank FreshBooks. They are a sponsor of this episode. And when I was a freelancer, I loved the freedom of working my pajamas, not wearing makeup, and being able to sing loudly to my music all day. And Jason wouldn't say, complain about how loud I was.
Yeah, singing in the office next to me while we're trying to put together TNT, it's a little distracting.
So, I'm not gonna lie. What I hated about being a freelancer was rummaging through receipts, trying to keep track of expenses, creating, formatting, sending invoices. The very worst is tracking down customers who did not pay me on time. Now, FreshBooks is a super simple cloud accounting software. It's giving thousands of businesses, just like yours, the tools to save time billing and get paid faster. Getting started on FreshBooks could not be easier, even if you're not a numbers person. You will be creating and sending invoices in minutes and get paid online right away with FreshBooks payments. Get paid upfront. Now you can request a deposit in FreshBooks. No more covering costs out of pocket or waiting until the end of a project to get paid. Plus, FreshBooks just announced their new card reader. Now you can easily accept credit cards wherever business takes you, quickly and securely right from your iPhone in less than a minute. FreshBooks card reader is EMV enabled. That's the chip card system. You've probably seen it on your new cards. Hopefully you've gotten your new cards. It's the new standard in the U.S., with their entirely redesigned iPhone app, you can now conduct business anywhere. You can send an estimate right after the handshake, send an invoice in seconds right from your phone. It is so easy to track all your billable time. Now you will know how long your projects really take. So throw away that shoebox where you're keeping all of your paperwork. Please track your expenses on the spot using your phone's camera. All this allows you to focus on what you love the most, growing your business. And you will wonder why you did not start with FreshBooks sooner. If you have questions, help is free forever. And you can always count on FreshBooks' award-winning support rock stars to go above and beyond whenever you need a hand. Getting started is simple, and it's totally free for 30 days. Go to freshbooks.com/TNT. And don't forget to enter Tech News Today in the How Did You Hear About Us section. You can start your 30-day free trial today, and we thank FreshBooks for supporting this episode of Tech News Today.
All right. We kind of like to end the show with a little interesting, kickerish sort of thing. Back in 2011, you may remember this, a monkey took a selfie. It happened in Sulawesi, Indonesia. Pretty sure I got that right. When a macaque monkey commandeered a British nature photographer's camera, took it over, snapped some dazzling images of itself, as you can see here. They did what you'd expect. They passed around the web pretty hard. People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals sued last September for the right of the monkey to own copyright for the images. We now know, thanks to today's judgment, that monkeys, or rather animals that are not humans, are not extended those rights according to the current treatment of the Copyright Act.
I like how you said they spread it around the web, like the monkeys spread it around
the web. I wish, actually, yes. That was maybe worded incorrectly.
The monkeys did not spread it around.
Who knows who started the spreading of those photos?
Well, it's interesting because the photographer, I mean, they're amazing photographs. And it was, I mean, the photographer's camera was great. He had set up the shot. He walked away to get something to eat or something. And then they took over. And this is the second case. The first one was brought by Wikimedia because they posted the pictures, and it was a copyright issue because then the photographer said, hey, those are mine. And he said, no, they're not. You didn't take them. You said on your website you didn't take them, like, because he told the story because it was funny. So then PETA, which I think the PETA, I interviewed the lawyer for the photographer on Tech News Tonight a few months ago, and I think this is just a crazy thing for PETA to do because this is a nature photographer. He loves nature. Like, he loves animals. He's trying to, like, spread the beauty of animals by being out there and taking their photograph, and then they try to say, like, the monkey owns its own selfie. So I am glad that they didn't win.
I mean, if I took a selfie on your phone, Megan, Would I own it or would you own it? I'm just curious.
That is a good question. I mean, we'd probably have to go to court because we're not monkeys. So,
people. It's true. Yeah. It would be nice if, like, PETA would just, like, maybe ask the photographer to, like, divert some of the money he's made from this photo, if he's made any money at all, which he probably hasn't, to you know, the monkey
or the monkey's family.
Or... Yeah, something like that. Because, you know, I like the spirit of what PETA's trying to say is, like, hey, if any money's made off this, it should go to the monkey because the monkey took the photo. But, I mean, the monkey doesn't have a bank account or like a Square Cash or like a Facebook Messenger account to receive money through, right? I mean, I don't know.
The monkey's just going
to
eat the money.
Yeah.
It's true.
or make a home out of the money. Well, there you go. A new home for the monkey using the money that he got.
Well, you know, when I talked to the lawyer, it was funny because he didn't want to talk. Andrew Dewey is the lawyer, and he didn't want to talk about the backstory at all. He's just like, this is cut and dry. Monkeys cannot sue, and no one can sue like on their behalf for owning something like this. Yeah. Like, it's just that unless Congress changes this, they can't. So it's cut and dry. But he was, I mean, he is a great, you know, this guy did contribute. I don't know like how much he contributed to these particular monkeys, but I know that he was a lover of nature, and you know, and so that was what was crazy. Because I think PETA's tried to do this before for like other animals in captivity, dolphins, you know, saying it's slavery. And I mean, I get that. Like, I support PETA's argument in that way. But with this, I'm not so much. So, hooray for the monkey.
Hooray for the monkey. It is a very legendary picture. You have to admit, like, you couldn't intend for that photo better than the monkey. I mean, the monkey obviously knew what it was doing.
Yeah.
Obviously.
So, I will, next time we're in the same place, I want you to take a selfie. I'll spread it around, see how much money I can cake out of it. But, and then, yeah, see what happens. But thank you so
much. I can't promise it'll be as good. But I'll try.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Nathan. It was great to talk to you. Nathan works at the Wall Street Journal. He's a tech reporter and just an amazing guy to talk to. So thank you so much for joining us. And what else are you working on now that you can tell us about?
Oh, a few things. I can't tell you about too much of them because the stories aren't done yet. But I should have some things coming up. A lot of stuff happening with virtual reality. And then some things that are kind of looking at design and technology and I think hopefully compelling ways. So there's a lot going on and we're definitely super busy out there. But yeah, thanks for having me on. It's always a good time.
Yeah, it's our pleasure, Nathan. Nathan Olivarez-Giles, we appreciate it. And we'll have you back soon.
Thanks.
Take care, sir. All right, tomorrow's guest will be Ryan Hoover. He's the founder of Product Hunt. Which is just an awesome site. If you haven't checked it out, you definitely should before tomorrow so that you know. And there you go. Ryan's super excited to have him on tomorrow. TNT records live every Monday through Friday. So that's tomorrow, 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern, 12 a.m. UTC at twit.tv/live. And you can be a part of the show by emailing us, tnt@twit.tv, or you can leave us a short voicemail at 260-TNT-SHOW. You can also hit us up on Twitter at TechNewsTodayTV.
And don't forget to subscribe to the show on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn, or your favorite podcast catcher. All the ways to subscribe are there on our show page at twit.tv/TNT. And if you want to get in touch with us, hit us up on Twitter. I am at Megan Morrone.
And I am at Jason Howell. And that is all we have for you today. Thanks for talking tech with us, and we will see you tomorrow. Bye, you guys.